everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, here finally back with Luis Scott-Vargas.
Yeah, I've been gone for a while, about a week in Paris and a week in San Diego, so heads
up. Sounds absolutely brutal.
Paris was actually a pretty stressful trip. I mean, after playing in the Pro Tour, you know, finishing well, doing all that, we go out to dinner, we're like, man, that was a good weekend. It's like, well, there's a GP tomorrow, so weekend's not over.
I think that's the best place to start this week. First Magic weekend, quote unquote. What was it like? How was it different than a Pro Tour?
Mechanically, it was different in that it starts a day earlier. Like, day one of the Pro Tour is on Thursday instead of Friday. So you go day one of Pro Tour Thursday, day two Friday. You see who makes top eight, who doesn't. Then day one of the Grand Prix Saturday. Then day two of the Grand Prix Sunday, along with the Pro Tour top eight. And in the case of one Paul Rietzel, who beat me playing for top eight, he went pretty deep in the GP. He finished 22nd. At the Grand Prix, despite having to take a match loss because he had to play his Pro Tour Top 8 match. He actually shows up, drafts his deck, goes takes a match loss while he goes and plays against Pat in the Pro Tour Top 8. Beats Pat 3-0, and if it was 3-1, it'd be actually much worse, because beats him 3-0, runs back, gets there just in time to play his Grand Prix round, wins that round, wins the next round, but then he ends up losing one of his other rounds, and he ended up finishing, I believe, X3. So 13-3 in the Grand Prix after making the finals of the Pro Tour.
Now, we joked before the first, like, you know, the hintings of a Magic weekend that, you know, how great would it be to have a dual champion? Like, why couldn't they have kind of structured it that way? Like, oh, the pros won't be able to play in the Grand Prix. But, you know, minus what seems like seven guys, pretty much everyone who was there for the Pro Tour probably played in the Grand Prix.
Yeah, I mean, they structured it well. I mean, the only people who are disadvantaged by this are the people who made top eight of the Pro Tour, which no one really feels sorry for, so, as it turns out.
But the real question is, would you prefer a structure that would allow one person to run them both?
Well, Paul could have won both if he hadn't lost any rounds.
That would have been, I mean, again, it's already an incredible feat just to be able to finish 22nd and second. But then on top of that, like, I mean, would you want to change
it? It would be nice if they could play day two of the Grand Prix without having to take any match losses. But I think they have a lot of complicated scheduling to do already, so I can't really blame them if that's the case. And again, it only affects eight people who who already made top eight of the Pro Tour. So
considering what Paul managed to do in the very first Magic weekend, do you think it's going to be a reality somewhere down the line?
I'm sure people are looking forward to trying to double queue and win both. But we'll find out whether that actually happens or not. I know Ben Stark was disappointed, because originally the top eight was told they wouldn't get to draft and they'd have to take a match loss for each round of the first draft. But it turned out that wasn't the case, and he already hadn't signed up for the Grand Prix at that point.
Oh. So
Ben S. Loves double queuing. In fact, when he plays online, he's frequently playing two or three tournaments at the same time. So his whole life in preparation for this, and he didn't get to do it.
Well, Mr. Stark is one of the guys that's usually in front of a computer screen when it becomes testing time, right? I mean, he's usually married to his MTGO.
Well, he plays a lot of Moto and uses it to test. But, I mean, when you can test online, he does. But when you can't, you can't. And he's certainly, you know, still a valuable member of the testing team. It's pretty awesome that he ended up winning. I mean,
which leads me right into the next question. What was it like testing in San Diego?
It was pretty awesome. Gabe had this like beachfront house where you could like go on the patio and see the ocean, and with, you know, hot tub and everything. So it was certainly a good relaxing environment, though not the most conducive to necessarily working all the time.
Yeah, I don't really know why you need the beachfront property in order to test Magic that much.
Well, it helped us, you know, get in the right mental state. But as it turned out, we got a lot of testing done. I mean, if you look at the final, you know, how the tournament ended up, we put six people playing our deck in the top 16, you know, and we won the tournament. So that's, you know, you have Ben S. and Tom Martell in the top eight, and then barely falling out of the top eight, you had Ifro at ninth, myself at 10th, Owen at 12th, and then a friend of mine, Eric Landries, who stayed at the same hotel as us, finishing 16th, also playing blue-white.
Yeah,
so. I mean, you can't argue with results, right?
You can't ask for anything more out of what you guys, obviously.
I could have asked for a couple, all the people who finished top 16 to top 8 instead. So,
okay. Again, as a team, I don't think you could have asked for much more. Now, again, leading right into my next question, you guys tested a lot of Besiege Limited, which a lot of other people probably didn't get a chance to do because they didn't have a group, they didn't have the product initially.
It's mostly finding a group of people who can get all in the same place, because we were able to get enough people like organized that we were able to, like, when we were in Paris, do a bunch of drafts and stuff. So it ended up working out quite well. I mean, we planned it, like we all reserved the same hotel, for example, so that we would be able to test very easily. And we ended up testing, drafting in the breakfast room of the hotel after breakfast was done. And that worked out pretty well. Doing a lot of besiege drafts was definitely important. I mean, after day one, I posted, because we had a testing thread on Facebook, I posted that we were like 23-4 in matches. All of us who had tested in the house, and that's a pretty impressive. And that wasn't even counting Bennett's, because he didn't actually go. So if we had counted him, it'd be 26-4. So
nice. So, what do you think about Besiege Limited being added to Scars now that you play with it so much? Kind of initial, like, not necessarily initial thoughts or technology, but
well, after playing it a lot, I've definitely got a lot of opinions on it. I do like it, at least for now. I mean, obviously, any format you play a ton, you eventually get bored of. But right now, I've played it a lot, and I'm still having fun with it. There's a lot of interesting decks to draft. I like the way the poison went. I mean, I've been a vocal critic of poison in the past. But now all the poison cards, like instead of Plague Stingers, you have Scourge Servants, which cost 5. So poison's been dialed back a bit in terms of its speed. It's still a good deck and still definitely an archetype you can draft. But it's no longer, you know, turn 2 Plague Stinger, turn 3 Sis Bear. Now it's more like Blight Widow into Scourge Servant or Sis Bear into Blight Widow. Like, it's a little more manageable. The games end up playing out better, so that's definitely an improvement in my eyes. There are a lot of good cards in Besiege. Like, there's a ton of bomb rares and bomb uncommons and stuff, but there's enough that you can usually get one. And an important part about this draft format is, like, I always take the best card out of, like, you know, the pack. Like, even in pack 2 or something like that, you're not going to see me passing Carnifex Demon or whatever. In my first draft at the Pro Tour, I was mostly red with a few off-color cards, and then I opened, and I passed a bunch of white in pack 1. But in pack 2, I opened Sunblast Angel, and without even worrying about it, just took it. So I ended up red-white, because I knew that Sunblast is a powerful enough card that I wouldn't want to switch colors, or I would not mind switching colors into it. As it turned out, I got past another one in pack 3, so pretty lucky, and
okay. Well,
had a pair of Sunblasts.
Kind of goes off the deep end at that point.
Well, I got Sunblast flooded one game, so.
Must be nice. And it's not, to me, it's not about mana fixing. Like, this isn't like a Shards-esque format where you're reaching a fourth or fifth color in one way or another. It seems like it's still, even with Besiege, it's still pretty heavy artifact base that allows you to play 3 or 4 colored spells of 2 different colors and mostly brown.
Yeah. So even though I say I switch colors a lot, it does not mean I end up 3 colors. I usually end up 2 colors, because between all the artifacts and like the couple colored spells you need, you don't need that many other cards to fill out your deck. So let's say, you know, you're going into pack 3, you've got a base of like 12, maybe 13 artifacts you're going to play pretty much no matter what. And you have 5 cards of one color, 4 cards of another color, so you're pretty well set up. But then you open a Horde Smelter Dragon, which isn't in either of your 2 colors. You're like, you know, green-blue or something. Oh, that's a pretty bad example, because that's like not a good color combination.
Blue-white.
But whatever, you're blue-white.
Sure.
And then you look at, you don't look because you're on the Pro Tour, and so you can't look at your cards, but you've already kind of indexed your cards in your head. You realize that Horde Smelter is better than all your white cards combined. So you take Horde Smelter Dragon, abandoning your like Arrest and 2 other mediocre white cards. But now you've still got, you know, 5 blue cards of Horde Smelter, 12 artifacts. You still need to pick up 5 playables out of this pack. And you're going to get past a couple red and blue cards plus more artifacts. So switching into another color doesn't really hurt you. And you can still end up 2 colors. It's not like you're now blue, red, splash white. Even though you could, you usually end up not being that. Like, you can end up in 2 colors without, and have enough playables even if you switch pack 3. So that's an important thing to learn about this format that a lot of people really haven't. I got past Sunblast pack 3, right? So
yeah, someone didn't know it, obviously. Now, kind of in triple Scars, you kind of had Infect, you had Metalcraft, you had like Dinosaurs, you had Furnace Celebration. There are some archetypes that people kind of, you know, lean towards. With Besiege, the amount you've played, do you think there's something new out there, a kind of new deck type or new kind of strategy that you've kind of found so far, or is it still kind of just augmentations on what we know?
To some extent, I mean, yeah, the Dinosaurs is still definitely a deck, as is like Sky Eel School, like, you know, a blue-based control deck. And in fact, it's clearly still a deck. Metalcraft has actually gotten a little worse in my estimation. Like, strict Metalcraft cards like Chrome Steed or Rusted Relic are just not that exciting. And the cards from Besiege don't really help it that much. But there's a slightly new archetype which involves like Ichor Wellsprings and ways to sacrifice them and Glenhawks to bounce them. Though, again, Ichor Wellspring being the only card of its type in the set means if you don't pick up 2, you can't really build around it as easily. So it's just something to keep in mind. Kuldotha Rebirth also got a lot better, the card from Scars, just because there's more artifacts to sacrifice, like Ichor Wellspring, and Battlecry guys kind of help pump it out. So I think a fast, aggressive white-based deck, like heavy white deck to play Leonin Skyhunters and Kemba's Skyguards, that doesn't necessarily rely on Metalcraft but has a lot of artifacts, is something that I know Webb drafted a lot and to fairly good success.
Man, where do the heavy arbalists fit into a deck like that?
You still play the heavy arbalists.
They just do it to get in there for the shot. Yeah. That seems pretty good. I mean, turn two flyer, turn three flyer, turn somewhere.
I mean,
in there.
My one loss in limited was to Shota, who put heavy arbalist on Soliton and just. So
that one we're all familiar with. It seems like the colored cards in Besiege are just kind of, there are more of them or they're better. Instead of triple scars, is that one of the reasons that Metalcraft probably?
I think to some extent, yeah, that's definitely true. You've got, the Chrome Steed equivalent is like the Razorfield Rhino, which costs 6. So at that point, you might as well just cast Texplate Golem and not worry about Metalcraft. So yeah, the colored cards are definitely, you have Leonin Skyhunters and Burn the Impures and, Ogre Resistor is a fine guy. He's not much worse than Chrome Steed, and he's certainly a lot less work to get him going. So.
Right.
Colored cards give you an incentive to play a lot of colored cards and not a lot of artifacts. So that definitely does impact it.
Okay. Well, I'm pretty happy with our analysis of limited stuff, or yours, and I just sit here and listen.
No, you had some good points. I hadn't thought about the fact that colored cards have gotten a lot better. I hadn't put it into words before, so.
Thank you.
TSG coming through with some good thoughts.
The assist, if you will. It's Stockton to Malone, or one way or another. I don't really know how
I don't know what those words mean.
I barely know what they mean. Something to do with jazz. I think it's like a band.
I actually do,
something.
But still.
But let's stop and talk about the deck that you guys all played in the standard side.
Yeah, that's definitely worthy of a topic in and of itself. There's a lot of names for it. I just called it the Stoneforge deck or Blue-White, but I mean, some people called it Cobblade, which I didn't really like. Kaga was fine. Cobblade, I wasn't a huge fan of.
Let's just kind of break it down. I mean, you're kind of still playing a Blue-White control shell, because you've got top-end stuff. Well, but you also have a whole bunch of tiny creatures.
The best way to describe it is calling it fairies. And PV mentioned it in his article. I'm sure everyone's going to mention it. Stoneforge Mystics, the new Bitter Blossom. But a lot of us came to that conclusion independently, so that's just, what we're going to call it. Because much like Bitter Blossom, you're a control deck, but if you play your 2-drop, you don't have to tap out again, and they're under a huge clock. Because let's look at what happens when you play a Stoneforge Mystic turn 2. Like against Valakut, for example, which is the deck we tested against the most. And the most popular deck. You play turn 2 Mystic, getting Sword of Feast and Famine. They play an Overgrown Battlement or something. You go land, go. On their third turn, they can play a spell, and hopefully you have the spell pierce for Cultivate or something like that. Or you just let their Explore, Resolve, or whatever. And then at the end of your turn, you put in Sword of Feast and Famine, you untap, equip, bash them, take a card, untap all your lands, and now you've got 3 damage and them discarding a card every single turn, plus double your mana, so you can go, in the next turn, pre-combat Jace, attack, untap all your lands. And you've got counter mana up every single turn, and the deck does have, 9 counters in it, between Spell Pierce, Mana Leak, Stoke, Rebuttal, and Deprive. So, I mean, it is an aggro control deck from that perspective. You put a clock on them and have counters, and the counters like Spell Pierce and Mana Leak. See, part of the problem is in a normal, blue-white control deck, they get worse as time goes on, because your opponent's like, well, I know you have Mana Leak, so I'll wait to play my Primeval Titan until 9 mana, because you're not putting me under any pressure. But now, they can't wait, because they're discarding a card every single turn. And you're getting ahead of them with Jaces and Gideons as you just tap out and untap all your lands. So it makes all your conditional counters way, way better and much more broken. So it really is like a fish deck. And then if you don't draw Stoneforge Mystic, well, you're still a blue-eyed control deck, where you still have, 4 Jace the Mind Sculptor, and you still got a 9 counter spells.
So Gideon Jura is still good against Valakut.
He's okay. Yeah.
Here's a circumstance where Stoneforge Mystic being a 1-2 actually goes a really long way, because now you get 4 toughness with the sword. One Lightning Bolt, 1 Valakut trigger isn't going to do the trick anymore.
Yeah, Lightning Bolt's still pretty good, because if you're not careful, they can bolt in response to you sorting, and then not only do you lose your whole turn, you don't have a guy in play, and you don't get to untap your land, so it completely throws you into disarray. But, you can play around that if they act like they have it. I played against Boros in round 14 or something like that. Round 15, yeah, round 14. And I played a Stoneforge. He, had a step links. Next turn, he, attacked and passed with 4 mana up, and I was pretty sure he had a Lightning Bolt and could pay for mana leaks. So end of his turn, I put in Sword. He didn't bolt it then because he wanted to really get me. I played I had 4 lands in play. I equipped Sword, and he goes Bolt, with 3 mana up. But But I had the one deprived, so I deprived his bolt, attacked, untapped my lands, played Jace, bounced his Steplings, and you know, that was that. So
really, this is a story about you having the Miser's deprived?
Yes and no. It is, but if I didn't have the deprived, I wouldn't have equipped there. I would have just played Jace, bounced his guy, and attacked for one.
Okay.
Or passed, whatever, because I knew what he had, and I'm pretty sure he was representing it, and I'm pretty sure he did it because he thought he was safe, because under most circumstances, he is. So this is, because the deck's known now, you can't just go sword equip attack, assume it's going to be all good. I mean, my one loss to Valakut was because he had Nature's Claim for my sword in game 3. You know, I go equip sword and attack, and he Nature's Claims the sword and blocks the Oracle. So that blew me out pretty good. So, and at moving forward, you can't assume Valakut's going to have nothing. Like, in our testing, we tested against Valakut when it did have stuff, but we expected the vast majority to have no instant speed answers, and we were right. Most of the Valakut decks were just, you know, sitting ducks for us, you know, smashing them with the sword, but now they're going to have Lightning Bolt, they're going to have Nature's Claim, they're going to have these cards that actually do impact your game.
For me, it seems like every time a Pro Tour happens, every time there's like the deck or like the best decks, kind of like the weeks immediately afterwards, it's like, well, is this something that's going to hold up in my local store, something I'm going to be able to play at a PTQ?
Right.
So really, how do you think do you think the deck is going to have to morph because Valakut is going to change its sideboard options because there's all these artifacts out there? Do you think it becomes nigh unplayable if there are more Boros decks and equipped Valakut decks? How do things change moving forward?
I think the deck's still going to be really, really good. I mean, the deck, it didn't feel bad against anything, really. Boros with Hero of Oxen Ridge, which is what I played against the last round, was tough. But there are ways you can definitely fix that. Like, just swapping in Condemns for Ousts, for example, or taking out Ratchet Bombs, putting in Condemns. Like, something that involves you having, like, at least 3 Condemns in your sideboard will make the Boros matchup infinitely better. Because not only can you kill Hero for 1 mana, you can kill an Adventure and Geared Guy for 1 mana. Like, it just gives you a cheap answer that actually stops their attackers. Yes, Valakut's going to side in answers, but the deck's already really good against Valakut. And you got Flash Freezes and stuff still after board. So, like, you know, you play Mystic, you know, they pass or whatever. You put in Sword, and then when you go to equip the Nature's Claim and you Flash Freeze it, you still get them. And they have to have multiple of these cards. And added to that, cards like Nature's Claim don't advance their like, normal game plan. So if you don't draw a Mystic and just draw a bunch of counters and Jaces, well, their Nature's Claims aren't going to do anything, and you're going to beat them on that basis. Like, one of the Valakut players I beat in round 1, he sided in Tumble Magnets against me to stop my Sword, which is reasonable, right? Tumble Magnet does stop your guy. But game 3, he drew 2 Tumble Magnets, and I didn't draw a Mystic. And so I just killed him with Jace's Ultimate. Well, he had 2 Tumble Magnets in play that weren't really helping him too much.
No. Yeah. That's awkward.
Yeah, so that was pretty good.
Okay, I mean, just being able to disrupt. I mean, the fact that the deck does play both ways. You mentioned Fish.
Yeah, I mean, they can get, if they side in too much creature removal, you can just get a Planeswalker, counterspell, heavy draw. I think this deck definitely has what it takes to move forward just because, you know, it provides a disruptive package that's also very stable, and it's got a lot of good sideboard options against cards that would beat it normally.
Well, the versatility, that's what I tell people. They always ask me, like, oh, how do the pros decide what they're going to play, or, like, why do they make these odd card choices? And, like, you know, they're really...
Sovok life stuff.
Yeah, they're really preparing for, like, the widest field possible. It's not, like, a local metagame.
Yes and no. I mean, yeah, you want game against everything. Like, like our sideboard, for example, we boarded in like 11 to 13 cards against aggro, depending on what aggro deck it was. And we knew we couldn't anticipate every kind of aggro deck, but we had a lot of cards like Oust and Ratchet Bomb that were just good against decks filled with cheap attackers. So we didn't actually have to know which aggro deck we were going to face to know that these cards would be decent.
Yeah, it's like you're not playing Celestial Purge specifically.
Exactly. That's a card we discussed, but it's like, well, what if you play against like the Mono Green Elf deck? Like, you can't afford to have these cards in it. And that's why I think now that we have a little better idea of what the metagame is going to look like, because it's post-Pro Tour and you're going to have a lot more information, you can refine your aggro deck or your aggro sideboard with cards like Condemn over Oust, or, you know, maybe cutting Ratchet Bombs for other, you know, sort of things. And going forward, you can narrow the scope of this deck. And I think it's a deck that can be very easily customized.
Excellent. Seems like we've talked about a lot.
Yeah, I think we covered Paris pretty well. And, you know, we've got a bunch of reports coming in from myself, PV, Ben S. We're going to see how everyone's different take on the Paris experience. Even though we all played the same deck, we still came across it in very different angles and, you know, had different tournaments. So.
And with all that, you're right back at it this weekend.
Oh, yep, GP Denver.
Over to Denver.
In fact, we'll be set up and you'll even be there too.
I will be there. I'll be watching from the sidelines, rooting you on, hoping it's not a gruesome encore
after you play,
of your previous experience.
Yes, a gruesome encore. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you all next week.